way that I do it for my patients that works well. I don't prevent anybody from eating their rice or their beans or the fufu that they eat, small quantities, multiple times at a time. It's best. That somebody will say, I only eat one a day. And when you see the plate they eat one a day, you think somebody died. So what happened? The plate is so big, they eat it once a day. That is dangerous. They know. You could eat your rice, small quantity, you know, better off multiple times a day is ideal. Because the small quantity you eat, your body is using it, you're actively burning it and you're getting back. Or like staying till evening at 10 o'clock, then you set it on to the So that is bad. Yeah, it's good.
Excuse me.
Oh, yes, please.
What time is good for the dinner? Time the best to eat dinner before you go to bed?
And they say anything that will give you another 4 hours before you go to sleep. So if you want to sleep at 10, 6 p.m. is ideal for dinner. Because you need enough time, you know. Not for those of us that work.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, please.
Maybe aspirin is good for thinning your blood. But however, if your blood is already thin and you are using the baby aspirin.
No, if your body is thin, we ask ourselves what could make our blood thin. Unless somebody is on Coumadin or other medical conditions that make their body thin, we know that we cannot give the aspirin. Anybody less than the age of 30, we don't put them on aspirin. You know, because there's something they call the Reye syndrome, so we don't do that. How would we know your body blood is thin unless we do a blood test called PTPTT to check it? Usually people's bloods are not thin.
When you say baby aspirin, are you talking about 81 milligrams?
Absolutely. 81. 81 milligrams is baby aspirin.
So is this
after being prescribed? Oh, nobody can. This is a healthy thing to check. If nobody can have 4 months without that time to be healthy.
Any more questions? About aspirin is to prevent blood pressure, right?
No.
And heart attack. I'm sorry.
Aspirin is good for a variety of things. It thins your blood, helps blood to flow, prevents a heart attack, prevents stroke. Yes.
My question is, they say aspirin causes a stomach ulcer.
Uh-huh.
So most of the people, when they get the aspirin, they don't
aspirin. Okay. Let's clear her question, because sometimes we see a good thing, we try to bring it down. Before you could take enough aspirin to cause your stomach ulcer, you have to take about 36 tablets of it a day. So it is not true. And the baby aspirin that we have is called enteric-coated aspirin. Check it out. Most of it is enteric-coated, EC aspirin. So that's the one you buy. It goes through the stomach. Before it gets to irritate the stomach, it has bypassed the stomach to your GI. So when you get an aspirin, get the EC aspirin, and enteric-coated, it does not affect any ulcer. That is not true.
Medication question is,
my understanding is that the flip side of taking aspirin is that it's difficult for you to have blood clots. In case you have a clot or accident or something, the blood will cut
completely. No, it will not. So his question is, when you take aspirin, will it for you to continue to bleed if you get a clot? No, it's not true. Because aspirin is not, it's not Coumadin. It makes it a little bit light. It's not too light. It does not affect your platelets. So the clotting factor is low.
Excuse me. So does it mean it's advisable to buy or have aspirin at home?
Yes, it is. For any man over the age of 50, yes. Woman over the age of 50, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you take it every day?
Every day.
Yes, president is taking it every day.
How you know?
I know. Yeah, Trump is taking aspirin every day.
Let's leave Trump out of this.
I do it, doctor.
Let me get that. Go ahead.
Can a woman get diabetes when she's pregnant? And if she can she pass on the risk?
What happened, please?
Can a woman get diabetes when she's pregnant? And if she can she pass on the risk?
Okay, so his question is, you know, when a woman gets gestational diabetes that we talked earlier, can she transfer it to the child? In most cases, no. Because gestational diabetes is something that affects the woman because of hormone imbalance, because of not enough insulin to deal with, you know, all that is going on with her. She does not transmit it to the child, absolutely not.
So after having control blood pressure.
Oh, from the food that we eat and the cutting down on salt intake, losing weight, increasing our exercise tolerance, if all that fails, medicine. When you come, okay, my question is this. Listen to this. My question is, can we clarify the ages for men and women when it comes to aspirin? When it comes to women, we have to put in equation their estrogen. So when we think about menopause, if any time the menopause occurs, that's when aspirin is needed for women. Unlike men, it's regimental, it's 50. So it could be 50 for a woman, it could be high because of estrogen. Most menopausal women need to be on aspirin.
Okay, you guys been good.
Thank you, Ben.
All right, thank you.
Attention. Okay. The each question I want to say is not pertaining to Morrison. But all of us here, we are from Nigeria. And this is Dr. Nwaso, and he's doing a great good job in Nigeria. So I want him to tell us about those things because he can benefit from me, from most of all of us. What he's doing, he's doing a
medical mission.
So he's doing it in Nigeria. And he's going to explain to us, because he called me and he explained to me, he said, if I want the program in my state or in my village, I should let him know they can take it there. And they will give people medication, everything, free glasses, which I know that will benefit for all of us. So I want him to tell us about this thing, because like me, I want them to take it to Lori.
Yeah. Don't worry. There it goes. Okay, let me give you a nutshell. What it is ever since I've been in the United States, I've been going home, you know, twice a year since 1985 to see how things are home. You know, I'm somebody that vested, you know, in Nigeria particularly, because I feel we all need help. You know, what we get here is the best care in the world. But what has happened with a lot of us, we have forgotten where we came from. Some of us are so complacent, you know, once we get our food, get our salary, get our apartment, water and electricity, we forget about people we meet at home. To me, it's a venture. I do it, you know, very much. Since 2008, I've been going home taking care of about 5,000 patients each time I go home. What do? I work with some group of people that you employ at home, you know, setting up what you call a medical mission. We could come to something like the Bronx, you know, in the South Bronx area, and then within a month, let everybody in the area, I'm talking, I'm giving an example, for them to gather, come on a particular day, 2 or 3 days, that we're going to make medical provision. What do? We put tents, like hospitals, and then provide things that will be there. I have been fortunate, you know, that want to feel donated best to me, you know, to use for this venture. Morrison that I work at donated the exam tables, about 30 of them, and keep them home. So when we get home, I hire about 10 doctors and 30 nurses, and we're able to see about 600 patients a day. How do we do that? 80% of it, I buy the medications here. I have very good friends in high places. So I buy medications cheap and send it home. Some companies donate it to me, and including glasses and all the rest of them. When we go, everybody that has diabetes, blood pressure, HIV, what have you, we give them medication for a month. And we buy medications that people can buy at home, not by giving them expensive medications here when you finish, they can't get it. So when you get like hypertension, we give them amlodipine. Amlodipine is the number one blood pressure in Nigeria. When they have diabetes, you give them glimepiride or metformin. They have it at home. So when they have arthritis, you give them ordinary naproxen, they have it at home. So what we have done is accumulate an effort, you know, to have an entity, build a little place where people will come and get medications, you know, free. You don't charge them. Have eye doctors check them? A lot of them. We have the worst eye situation in Nigeria. When you do the medical mission, over 3,000 people in just eye is the worst that we have at home. Glaucoma, near blindness because of diabetes. When you go to the western states, you see more diabetes. When you go to the eastern states, you see more hypertension because of our diabetes. Varies. That's what I'm beginning to see by what I do. So on a given time, like, you know, I go every June and every December. So we do this. We call on people. Somebody says, you know, we like it to be done in Lagos and in London. We say, tell your people if they can defray some of the costs, we come in there. So we'll do it for 2-3 days. Usually I'm home. People, they have my website. They come in, they volunteer. You hire like about 10 doctors, 30 nurses, and they sit there. We keep seeing patients. We have an efficient system that we could be able to see 600-700 patients a day, and everybody gets their medication. And we're fortunate people are donating medications to help me do this. So this is something that I'm doing out of my own, you know, shared care for home. And then hoping that one day we're going to get primary care, like the way Morissette gives it to people, because that's what I want. That's what I'm trying to relate. We have people come every day to take their blood pressure, diabetes, all these things, and they're well and don't end up in the hospital. There's no need to be in the hospital. You get them well early and they'll be all right. So we're doing it, and then she will share some of what we're doing at home so you can see how we can bring it to other homes. Please don't be complacent and love America too much. Think about people that we left. If people like Awolowo, Zeke, and all the rest of them did not think about Nigeria to have independence, we still will be in the blind up to today. So that's why I don't care that, you know, one person is trying. A lot of people look at it and say, there's nothing I can do. Yes, there's a lot to do. You know, somebody does not know that the $50 that they put in can provide prenatal for 100 women for 1 year. Think about that. Somebody comes into a clinic because of your $50, they get prenatal every year and every day for the 9 months that they're pregnant in something. Each and every one of us can help in any way we can. And you can help your own community. I don't say do it for all. Let's start from one locality at a time. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
What? They don't want to collect it. That thing here hurt.
Diver.
They're not going to collect it.
Tell them that you're going home. You're going to take it. Oh. See, your mom is going to leave.